and I'm an experienced chemist with 25 years experience, and I would like to speak with you today concerning a topic that you probably know quite a bit about if you have animals, and that is ammonia. And I would like to talk to you about how ammonia affects the health of your pet. And the reason it's important is because pets are our family. You can see we have SuperZoo, where $60 billion a year is spent on our pets. But what you may not know is how the ammonia generated from the waste of your animals can affect their health. So what is ammonia, and what do you as pet parents need to know about ammonia? Well, it's a colorless gas, so you can't see it. But the good news is, it's not horrible, so you can smell it at very low levels. Very low, as in 3 parts per million. So you can smell it as soon as it starts to generate, you're able to detect it. It comes from biological systems, which I'll talk about in just a moment. But what you need to know is it's very dangerous to the health of your pet. Especially the smaller the pet, the greater the risk. The older the pet, the greater the risk. And I call it the silent pet killer. Ammonia exposure is very unhealthy for your pets. So where does it come from? I know you see some chemistry up here, and I promise I will not give you a chemistry lesson because it makes my colleagues break out in hives and have heart palpitations. So this is all the chemistry you're going to see. But where does it come from, this ammonia? Well, it comes from bacteria. And inside certain bacteria, there is an enzyme called urease. And this is a picture of the urease enzyme. And what happens is when your animals urinate into the catwalks or the small animal cage or your horse stall, there's a reaction between this particular enzyme and the urea from their urine. This bacteria will come from the fecal matter, it'll come from the bedding, it comes just from the general environment. So bacteria loves temperature range 50 to 140 degrees Fahrenheit, which is pretty much where we all live in. Loves relative humidity, so the more moisture you have present, the greater chance the bacteria will grow. And bacteria grow in exponential numbers. So you have a few colonies this morning, tomorrow morning you have exceptionally more, and then exponentially more by the third day. This gives you ideal conditions for bacterial generation. So the bacteria enzyme is always reacting with the urea, forming ammonia, water, and carbon dioxide. So how does ammonia affect you as humans? So the OSHA, or Occupational Safety and Health Administration, has determined exposure limits for humans, for industrial workers and agricultural workers. So they came up with some limits. So the short-term exposure limit is less than 15-minute exposure. The long-term exposure limit is over an average 8-hour period of time. This is the amount of ammonia that they feel is safe for workers. And then they have immediately dangerous to life and health, which means your health will be affected immediately, and it can include up to and leading to death. So for humans, they base it off an average weight of 154 pounds. So for humans, we can be exposed in less than 15 minutes, short term, to 35 parts per million. Remember, you can smell it at 3 parts per million. So by the time you're smelling it, you're working your way up to this minimum exposure level. And then long term, over 8 hours, 25 parts per million. And then remember this number, 300 parts per million is when it starts being immediately dangerous to your health as a human, giving you chronic health conditions up to leading to death. So what does this really mean? Short-term exposure can give you coughing, sneezing, runny nose and throat irritation. It can lead to vomiting and diarrhea as well. Long-term or chronic exposure over time, headaches, nausea, intense irritation of the skin, burning of the eyes, etc. immediately dangerous to life and health. So if you're exposed to 300 parts per million or greater, then this can actually burn the trachea of a person or animal. This particular picture is a picture of a cat trachea. This is the normal trachea. This is a damaged trachea. The damage cannot be reversed. Once your animal has had tracheal damage, lung damage, you cannot reverse that over time. So what symptoms do you need to look for your pets? Runny nose is the number one thing. Their eyes will start running, their nose will start running, and then vomiting is the next most common symptom. They go in the cat box where there's a high level of ammonia, they come out, they sneeze, they vomit. You think they're vomiting because they have a hairball. Now, they've been exposed to too much ammonia. It will lead in horses to loss of appetite, and then even hoof disease. Standing in a stall that's wet constantly with all this bacteria and ammonia generation and lead to hoof disease. And then it can, you know, over time, difficulty breathing, then it leads to bronchitis and pneumonia. So ammonia is very dangerous to your pets. So what pets are at risk? The better question is, what pets are not at risk? I don't have pictures of puppies and dogs up here, but if you have puppy pads or you have the fake turf grass in your home and you're generating a lot of ammonia, they're exposed as well. Pigs, llamas, I mean, you name the whole animal kingdom, you're at risk, even fish and birds. But I wanted to talk today, starting with small animals. And they're so cute, they're just adorable. But they just run around in their cage and they just really go potty wherever they want to. So if you look at the short term and long term exposure levels based on a 0.2 pound hamster, significantly less than 1 parts per million. And you can't smell it until it's 3 parts per million. So by the time you smell their cage, you are already exposing them to high levels of ammonia. And they're just really teeny tiny things. So the more they breathe, the greater impact to their health. And they stay in this stinky cage all the time. That's their home. There was a study that actually went and checked over 400 cages. They found the levels were greater than 100 parts per million. That's greater than the human short-term and long-term exposure level. These cages, the way they're designed, are mainly closed cages. The levels within a week's time can be as high as 200 parts per million. So the little guy is just sitting in there breathing all these toxic things, and you may not can see the damage it's doing to them, but it will burn their feet, they'll have hair loss, they'll sit, they'll shake, and they just become very unhealthy very quickly. You can change their bedding 24 hours later, boom, high levels of ammonia. So what can you as pet parents do to mitigate ammonia for your small animal? Well, I know that the cage on the left is the new trend. I've walked around SuperZoo. I've seen some really cool designs. Lots of places for them to run and play and tunnel and do what little rodents do. But unfortunately, it's a closed system with very little airflow. The more ammonia they generate, where does the ammonia go? It just stays right there in the cage with them. So no matter where they go, they're going to be breathing it in. So the picture on the right is an open cage concept, which is what I recommend, because you want a lot of air circulation to take care of that ammonia. Ammonia is lighter than air, so it will rise. And so the more air circulation you can have, the better. Another recommendation is to change the litter as often as possible. I did a study. Does anybody have a guess the average time that a small animal pet parent changes their bedding? No guesses? 2 weeks. Average is 7 days. They do it every Saturday or Sunday. By the time they do it, you're at the 100 to 200 ppm level. And humans, we cannot detect the difference between 3 ppm and 200 ppm. So by the end of that 7 days, you're even exposing yourself to health issues. another thing is their water bottles, when they move and they lean, and the water will just start dripping in one spot. Drip, 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 drip. So does that baby. What did I tell you that bacteria love? They love moisture. They love the temperature of your home. So what's going to happen is it's just going to grow exponentially. One thing to do to reduce that is use at least 2 to 3 inches of bedding in the bottom of their cage. So if you can prevent the water and the urine from going to the bottom, that's where most of the bacteria is generated. It gets underneath the bedding and it just gets happy. It just multiplies, multiplies, multiplies. And one little tidbit, no offense guys, but male animals of all species tend to produce more urease positive bacteria than female males. Just put it out there. So what about current odor control for bedding? Well, currently on the market, the main thing is a fragrance to mask the ammonia. So when you put it in, it smells like lavender or eucalyptus, and it smells really good for about 12 hours. And that's about as long as it works. If you use a natural bedding such as pine or cedar, you may have a little longer lasting fragrance, but at the end of the day, you're just basking. Well, I made a trip over to the new products that are coming out. There are actually two new products that are coming onto the market for small animal bedding. One of them is an absorbent. So all it does is absorb urine. There's no control there of odor. There's no prevention of it. And the other one is a neutralizer, which it's a chemical that's added to the bedding. And when the ammonia is formed, it will have a chemical reaction and neutralize it. But when the neutralizing agent runs out, you have more ammonia. So you have to constantly reapply, reapply, reapply. I'm working with Warren's Animal School of Wellness to bring to you a product that I developed. It's called PRIVENTZ, and it prevents ammonia formation from ever forming. It goes back to that chemical reaction where the bacteria is, and it doesn't allow it to interact with the urea to form ammonia. It's very safe technology, and I'll talk to you a little bit about that. What can you do to mitigate ammonia in your horse stall, or your horse farm? You may not know this, but the new trend in the pet industry is high protein diets, which is great for your pet for a number of health reasons. Unfortunately, there's a little downside to that. The higher the protein content in their food, the more bacteria positive, urease positive bacteria that they generate in their fecal matter. So you're increasing their protein load, increases the amount of bacteria in their feces, which reacts with the urea from their urine, and boom, you have a successful ammonia generating problem. I would suggest that you minimize the time in their stall. I know this is not always possible. A lot of people have to board their horses, and they can only go out certain times of the day. Same thing for show horses and race horses. But if you can minimize the amount of time in the stall, the better for the horse. Cleaning the bedding once a day, it really needs to be more than that, but a minimum once a day, but not just the manure or the fecal matter. You need to try to get out as much of that wet bedding as you can. An increase in air circulation is so important. If you can have fans, or even air conditioning units, which I know is extremely expensive. But there are some odor controlling agents out there today. A lot of people will use a lime, which is calcium oxide, which is a neutralizer. So again, if you have the neutralizing agent present, when that ammonia is starting to generate, it will neutralize it and shut it down. But you have to continuously add the neutralizing agent. So ammonia up, ammonia down, ammonia up, ammonia down. So this is an everyday kind of thing. Using Clorox to clean the flooring is a really good job of killing any bacteria that's down there. Clorox is a great antimicrobial agent, so it'll pretty much wipe out any bacteria that's there. When you clean out a concrete stall floor and you power wash with Clorox. There's an absorber that's very popular in the market called Sweet PDZ. It's a zeolite, which is a formulated type mineral that will absorb moisture. So it will pick up the urine. You have to put it down every day, just like a neutralizing agent. And then, of course, there's going to be PRIVENTZ very soon, which you add to your stall that will prevent the formation of ammonia in the first place. And then finally, cats. My favorite. I have three cats. And I have a dog, Bella. I bought her a pink tutu yesterday with some cupcake perfume. So, but I do have three cats at home. So what about cats and the exposure level to cats? Look at this. Short-term exposure level, 3.4 ppm. So as soon as you start to smell the ammonia, you best believe your cat is going to be affected by this ammonia gas. The long-term is 2.4, so over 8 hours is less than three. So before you can smell it, they have some effects. And the dangerous level is 30. That's not so bad. Except for the fact, if you have multiple cats in multiple boxes, each box is generating, as you can see, up to 15 ppm in just a few days. This cartoon is so cute. Have you ever smelled a smell so bad that your nose tried to hide inside its face? Yes, I have. The message from your cat to you, please clean my rooms. And I know that the trend right now is to have some really beautiful pieces of furniture that hide the stinky cat box so that your friends and your family won't see it, because you want them to say, oh, I didn't know you had a cat. Because what you're worried about is when they come into your house, they smell your nasty cat box. So you have this beautiful furniture, little cat door, they go in there. That's great for you as a pet parent. It's not so great for your cat, because what's happening inside that cabinet? Or what's happening inside this little plant planter? The ammonia is generating, it's building up, and every time they go in there, boom, they're getting a dose of really high ammonia. So the other thing that's real important, besides cleaning it every day, obviously, once a week, dump this box. Do you see all this residual? That's bacteria. You want to clean it out with antimicrobial soap or Clorox before you add your fresh urine. Natural litters are good, they smell nice with that fragrance. There's really no odor control there other than the fragrance. And also they just start decaying as well. That bacteria loves to break down corn and pine and all those goodies, the natural things. So I recommend that you use a pumpkin clay, which when they go, it forms a tight clump. It's easy for you to scoop and get out of the box. The more urine and feces you can remove from the box, the better. And of course, manage their high protein diets. There's a number of agents who control ammonia. Control. All they can do is control. We've talked about neutralizing agents. We've talked about odor masking agents. We've talked about the absorbers. There's a new product that actually will seal it in once it hits the litter. It will seal in the odor to prevent it from coming out. But this is where you want to be. You want to prevent. You want to inhibit that chemical reaction between the bacteria and the urea. So I've been researching this for a couple of years now, and I'm going to show you the results of my treated litter against all of the major brands. This black line is 3 parts per million where you can smell it. Day one, fresh box. Everybody's been Clorox cleaned. Put new litter in. Everybody's at 0. By day 5, everybody's above 3 ppm. Look at me. By day 8, wow, look at that. This pink line is just virgin bentonite clay with nothing else but it. The PRIVENTZ numbers is virgin bentonite clay and just my goodies incorporated into the litter with nothing else. No masking, no neutralizing, no anything else. By day 10, even your major brands that claim lots of things, I'm still here. I've taken it on out to 15 days. I've taken it as far as 17 days. Had to stop the test. I didn't smell ammonia. There was no ammonia coming on my little testing kit. But my cats ran out of places to potty. There was no more potty. So I had to stop. So the School of Animal Wellness, I appreciate you guys letting me come and speak to everyone about the effects of ammonia on your pets. I just want you to know PRIVENTZ is completely safe for your pets. It's non-tox, non-haz. If you eat it, it goes right through your liver, right through your kidneys, right on out of your body. So it does not harm you in any way. And we're going to have multiple options. It will be incorporated into litter. And we're working with Bentonite Performance Materials folks. And we're working with the Horn folks to bring you, private branded folks, a cat litter that prevents ammonia. We're also going to have a standalone sprinkle that you can put on top of the litter. So if you want to use a natural litter, that's more, you know, your cat likes that, or your cat prefers the non-clumping clay, just sprinkle it on top, gives you the same effect. We'll have one for horse dogs and for small animal bedding, because we want to bring you a game-changing solution that will prevent these harmful gases from your home. Not just the smell, but we want to take away that danger to you as pet parents and to your pets. Thank you so much for coming. I hope you have a great rest of your day. You can see Horn. Horn's booth is right here. You can chat with any of the Horn folks, and they can tell you how you can get this if you want to have your own, or if you would like to, if you're just a pet parent and you want to purchase it as a consumer. There are numerous companies that are starting to look at putting it in a package and putting it on their shelves. This is very early. This is the first time we've talked about it at a trade show. Of course, I'm hoping by the time we hit global in February, I'll have a lot more to tell you. But if you have any questions, I'll be glad to take those. Or you can see me afterwards. We can kind of get booted for the next speaker.